How's it going, man?
Good. How about yourself?
Not too bad. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah, I got you. You're coming through clear.
All right, perfect, man. Thanks so much for coming on the show, man. Basically, what I've been doing here called the Buzz In series, where I have bands buzz in since we can't have guests live in the studio currently. But I appreciate you calling in, man. Are you out in Sacramento?
Yep. I'm in Sac right now.
Well, like I said to you via email, like we've met in the past briefly in passing when both of our bands were on tour back in the glory days of rock and roll. And so I was...
those were the glory days? Oh, man.
But I was really stoked over because I saw you guys had popped up some new music, and I thought it'd be really cool to see if Zach wanted to come on the show. So I really appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah, no problem, man. Glad I could do it.
You and Sean started Middle Class Rut, obviously, together as a two-piece band. But you guys had been – one thing I always liked about your band, and maybe this isn't true, so you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I always had heard that you and Sean had been playing together since you guys were teenagers. Is that true?
Yeah, probably since junior high. Junior high we met, and then started playing together the same day.
As someone who was in bands most of middle school and high school, I always thought it would be really cool to like actually get in a band and get a deal and get to tour with like, you know, a lifelong high school, middle school friend like that. I mean, that's really rare. How many years going have you guys been playing together then?
It's been a lot of years. Over 20 years. I don't even know. I lost track. 25 years, something like that, maybe.
That's amazing.
Forever. No, I mean, I don't ever recall life any other way, I guess. I mean, that was sort of such a key time. The second I picked up a guitar and he had just happened to pick up the drums, and then we met and just jammed that same day just by chance. And then we kind of have been playing together ever since.
That's amazing. You wrote New Low that day and your life was changed forever.
Yeah, I wish. Yeah, that took another 10 years to happen.
It always does. So you guys started a band called Leisure, and you signed to DreamWorks in 2000, right?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah, and I mean, at that time, man, DreamWorks was definitely like the juggernaut of the music industry. I had some friends that were on that label at the same time. You might be familiar with them, a band called Creeper Lagoon. And
some of them are based in Sac, aren't they?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I think Sharky still lives out there. One of the guys is in San Francisco, but definitely a Southern California band. But they were also on DreamWorks, and that, you know, at that time, whenever it was, you know, one of the biggest labels around. How'd you guys come along to get signed to DreamWorks back then?
You know, when Sean and I started playing, we kind of got a manager right away, and our manager also managed Papa Roach.
Okay.
And so we started playing shows together all the time, and then they started blowing up locally, and, you know, we started doing real well locally, and then they ended up signing to DreamWorks, and after that happened, our manager got us a showcase, and we showcased for the head of DreamWorks as just a three-piece with no singer, because we had gotten rid of all our singers. So we played like five instrumentals in this small rehearsal space in Hollywood. And the guy, he's just like, man, you guys are really good. And the reason we're doing that is because we're actually trying out, you remember that band Lifehouse?
Oh, yeah.
Well, the deal that the way we got the showcase was because our manager was like, yeah, this would be a perfect band for this guy. And so it was just a fluke thing, like that we're showing him that we could play our own songs. And he's like, man, you guys are way too heavy. Like, you need to be doing your own thing. So he basically signed, you know, we didn't really have an interest in being that guy's band. It was just kind of an in for us. So he signed us to a publishing deal so that we could move down to L.A. and have money to live and then find a singer. So we signed to them before we even had a singer.
That's amazing. So was it Jason Wade? Like, you guys would have been the backing band for Lifehouse?
Exactly. You know, that first single, whatever that first single was, we learned that and played it. And then we're like, all right, cool. So that's how it would sound. But then we played like three or four of our own songs. And, it was just a trip. The whole thing is weird to even think about. 'Cause then he blew up and, it was just total opposite style of music, but the in sort of worked for us. You know, our manager was smart.
Yeah. It would have been totally different. I mean, that's pretty wild comparison of bands for sure.
Yeah, man.
That's amazing. But the timing, so you guys are out there in 2000, you're on DreamWorks, and you actually shared a picture on Instagram a while back on the Middle Class Rut Instagram page, and it was of you hanging out with, it looked like the Osbournes right around, it seems like, that time. Was that a pretty wild time? And back in the industry in those days, I mean, there was so much money and so much, just everything was such a big thing. How was that being a young guy signed to such a major label?
It was great. I mean, I think we got that 2000, 2001 was sort of the last of these giant deals. So we, you know, I don't know, how old were we when we signed it? I was probably 18 or 19. Sean was 18.
Yeah.
So we just got way more money than, it's not even real money. You know, it's just, the numbers just are, they're fake. So we're like, cool, let's move down to Hollywood. We just graduated high school and then we got a place. You know, we bought an apartment right behind the Roxy in Hollywood and just paid for rent for a year. And, just post it was crazy. I mean, it was, you know, it was good and it was bad. In SAC, we were grinding so hard and doing anything we could. At that point, it felt like we'd been doing it forever, but you know, we'd only just been going for a few years. But then you get handed all this money, you move down to some nice apartment. Now all of a sudden you're just going out in Hollywood every night. And like the last thing on your mind, especially being that age, is like even writing music. You know, it's just sort of, that took a back seat. And so, yeah, I mean, we ended up becoming friends with the Osbournes for a couple of years. I mean, we'd hang out with them at our apartment every day. You know, that's all we did. Wake up at 12, 1, they'd show up. We'd go find some food, figure out what we're going to do. Like that's sort of what life was, you know. It was just, it's completely not even realistic to real life.
And I feel like that's one of the situations too. You're right. It's at that time, you know, it's like all of a sudden the songwriting takes a back seat and everything. I mean, you guys disbanded, I believe it was 2003. Did you guys lose the DreamWorks deal? What was the reason for the disbanding?
Well, we finally found a singer and then we started making our first record with Joe Barisi, and who's still a good friend of ours. You know, he did, yeah. He's done everything. You know, he did the latest Tool record. He's just been around forever. And we went to Sound City in Van Nuys and started making our first record with him, and it was great, you know. But we finished the music in maybe 2-3 weeks, and then the singer that we'd got just wasn't cutting it. You know, it took him another 10 months of trying to do vocals.
Oh wow!
And it was just a disaster, and we sort of knew, but it was what it was. And then we went on tour. We went out on tour with CKY whole thing was pretty big, and that was awesome.
Yeah.
Then we scrapped that whole record, and DreamWorks was like, look, we'll give you some more money to make another record. So then we went to Ojai outside of Santa Barbara, made another record, and then they kind of said, all right, well, that's cool, but we're going to drop you. And then they gave us some money to leave the label.
Man, so yeah. And I think at that time too, like I have a lot of friends who were in bands around that same time that lost their deals or ended up leaving deals or whatever the case may be. And it was long before like social media. And I think a lot of kids today don't really grasp, you know, nowadays, like when you get dropped from a label, you've got your Instagram, your Twitter, you can still reach your fans. But, you know, leaving a label in 2003, it's kind of like the lights go out, you know. Did it feel like that at the time?
Yeah, it just felt like, you know, we've spent the past 3 years not really even accomplishing anything except, you know, just, I don't know what we did. You know, we never released a single thing in that band, which is so strange to see, you know, the type of stuff that gets thrown around and the opportunities, and you just, and then it just all goes away and it's like it never happened.
Yeah.
You know, so it, like as soon as that happened, we all just were tired of each other and we just went our separate ways. Sean, moved back up to Sacramento and started building a studio at his parents' place where we would then end up, forming Middle Class Rut and then recording pretty much all of our stuff in.
And how did that come about? So you guys take your own separate ways and then you and Sean just come back together. Was that intentional? I mean, you guys have been playing together so long. Was that an intentional thing or just kind of accident, like an accident?
You know, I stuck around Hollywood and kind of played with some buddies and, you know, just nothing was exciting. And he's like, man, I got this studio going. You should come check it out. Cause he was a runner at Sound City before he moved back up to SAC. And so he had met some guy who sold him this crazy console, like a 20-foot-long console. And he brought it up in a U-Haul and got it working somehow or another and then, you know, put it on a stand. And so when I walked into the room, I was like, oh, my God, it's just this huge console. It felt awesome. And he showed me some of the stuff he'd been working on. And right away, we started writing music. And then it was like, well, are we going to find a singer again? You know, that's all we've been doing for what felt like 10 years at that point. And that's when we sort of decided we had maybe 4 or 5 songs. And we're like, look, I said, you know, we should sing. I knew Sean's always been able to sing, but I'd never tried singing before or writing or anything. So I didn't even start that until my mid-20s, where I just sort of decided, all right, well, look, if we're going to do it, we got to make sure that we can do it ourselves.
See, I didn't know that. I imagined you'd sang the entire time. What was it like when you realized you can sing? Because you got a hell of a voice, man. You really do.
Thanks, man. I don't know. I was just listening to a ton of Fugazi at the time. And I was listening to these voices, and they were just raw, and they weren't like what you would think of as like a singer, but it was just, it hit me so much harder than anything. I was like, man, I feel like that's sort of what would happen if I opened my mouth. And sure, you know, I found out, wow, I can kind of yell and scream, and Sean's register kind of sits under mine. So our harmonies instantly were locking in, and we're just like, man, why did it take us, you know, what felt like forever just to even get to this point? Because it didn't really, for us, it didn't even really start until that point. And we had already been playing together for over 10 years, you know?
Yeah. No, that's what's amazing about it. Then to come out where it's just the two of you in the end, that's actually really amazing that it wasn't an intentional thing. Because then in 2007...
Yeah, it's a long way around.
Yeah, definitely the long way for sure. In 2007, Sacramento Rock Station, I think it was called KWOD, featured New Low as like a local feature, which I love that story because that's one of the things I do here at the radio station. I'm on air 7 days a week, but I get to have a show where I just play like local bands. I play whatever I want. And I think in AAA radio, that's a really magical moment that a lot of stations have abandoned. So when I heard that about you guys, I thought that was great. I mean, so the local feature picks it up, and I mean, then it seems like it started to kind of take off from there. That's amazing.
Yeah, what was interesting about them is that at that time, you know, the station's obviously no longer around, but they had this feature where it would play, they'd play maybe in the morning, then in the afternoon, then on the drive home, then at night. So you had a chance, if you were a local band, you had a chance to get heard sandwiched in between all the national bands, which was just unheard of, you know? And I remember we had all these demos that we did, and I mailed in three songs with like a letter and our logo and like, hey, this is what, you know, this is kind of what we do. And I never heard anything. And then a month later I was driving and I turned the radio on and then the song was there. I'm like, man, no one even let us know. And then from there, it just sort of, it blew up. I mean, we booked a show a month later and it completely sold out. Like just that New Low, just boom, it just struck everywhere. You know, it was like wildfire.
And is that whenever Bright Antenna was the label that you guys released your two records following that on? How did that come? I was always a big fan of that label. I think as far as indie labels go, they really have a good major like arm reach. How did that come about getting with Bright Antenna?
Well, when we first started writing these middle class rut songs, we had the same manager. We kind of come back to him, the one that I mentioned before. And he actually got us, we signed to Island Def Jam as Middle Class Rut.
Oh, wow, okay.
And so we were on Island Def Jam, you know, because it signed with them, got a publishing deal and started making our record here in Sac. And then, you know, when rock sort of the bottom fell out, we got dropped before we put out a record with them. And they dropped us with New Low also. You know, we had New Low. We had Busy Being Born. We had all those songs, but they just kind of got rid of us. And so then we back to the drawing board. Then that's when we started New Low started blowing up, and then all these labels came knocking. And Bright Antenna was just they were just the most down to earth people, hardcore supportive. You know, we had families by that point, so touring was like a different dynamic as far as what we needed. And they were just awesome, like complete freedom to do our thing, and endlessly supportive. And it was sort of a no-brainer for us. You know, we liked how self-contained it felt, and they were based out of Oakland, which was just right down the road.
Especially coming out of the major label machine twice at that point, that had to be pretty awesome to work with a big, strong indie like that.
Yeah, it was, you know, and you know, once things pick up in one area, it's just everything else is easier. You know, it makes it easier. Tours were just coming in, you know, we couldn't like, you know, book them fast enough. And you want to tour this band? Okay, this band gave you an offer. This band gave you, it's a trip, you know. It's kind of, we're doing all these tours that, you know, we're tripping out. Oh man, Alice in Chains asked us to go out, you know, and we'd grown up in love with that band, wearing their t-shirts every day. So it just, it was cool. It was cool to be exposed and like to have been working so long and like to get to that point where we felt sort of, you know, good to be able to showcase what we do.
Oh, dude, vindication at its best for sure.
Yeah.
That's a good way to bridge my next question. I always ask bands when they come on the show, I always ask them, like, what is one moment, like when things like that are happening, what is a moment that comes to your mind, if you can think of one at the top of your head, when you thought to yourself, wow, this is like catching on, like this is actually happening to us, like this band is actually taking off. Do you have a moment that sticks out where you thought that?
There was a tour that that we had booked, a headlining run after doing a million support runs. And we, you know, had no idea, you know, at this point we didn't even tour with any crew. It was basically just Sean, myself, and our buddy who was doing nothing but hanging out and sleeping in the van, you know. He didn't help in any way. So we're so stripped down, but we booked this run and it started, we're showing up at all these places and there's lines and there's posters up and, you know, you turn on the radio and we're hearing our song. We're like, oh my God, this is crazy. This is like, you know, we've never even been to these places and these shows are packed. That's when it felt like, all right, yeah, the people are definitely getting it. And like, you know, the song is hitting how it should.
Everything starts to like fire off at the same time. I love that. And then 2013, yeah. Pick Up Your Head comes out. I'm a big fan of that record too, man. And Aunt Betty did really well at radio really quickly too. I remember that song took off and I was on the road at that time. And I feel like every time we were anywhere, I would hear that song in the radio. So that one definitely had a lot of success too. How was that album cycle? Because that was definitely at that point you guys added, I think it was, you were like a five piece at that point in time too.
Yeah, at that point, I think we, you know, before our first record had come out, we had released two EPs by ourselves and then a third EP under Bright Antenna. So we've been touring almost what felt like nonstop. It was just 3 weeks on, a week and a half off, all non, you know, over and over. I think, you know, we go to the UK six times a year, something insane.
Oh, wow.
Like that.
Yeah.
And so we're burning out like crazy. Even the process of Pick Up Your Head, like, it was written, you know, most of it was written just at my mom's house because I didn't have a studio then. And, you know, with weird pots and pans that I'd set up and compress for percussion because we weren't really jamming at the time. So it just was this weird, weird record, you know. And then we ended up renting out Pop Roach's studio. And then Sean came down and we sort of finished it. And then that's when Dead Eye was written and like Policeman, a few other ones off there that sort of like rounded it out. But, yeah, by then I just remember feeling fried, like, just tons more tour dates, but not necessarily any huge growth. It just felt like we were just trapped in the machine without, like, we'd sort of hit a wall at that point. That's kind of my memory of it.
Yeah, because I saw you guys actually on that tour. It was I'd seen you guys obviously in the festival days, but I was here in Nashville and you played this little club called The End, and it was an amazing show. And I remember it was a smaller turnout, which bummed me out. But you guys sounded amazing.
Was that with all the guys?
Yeah. You had like, I think it was five. You had like a dude playing like a trash can lid. It was awesome.
Yeah. Man. We it was just like we got to switch it up. There's no way we're gonna play the tracks, and you know we have all this percussion and all this stuff going on, so we just figured, well, what better way to switch it up? And the second we did that, you know, everyone's like, oh, you were so much better as a two-piece. You know how it is though, you can't make anyone happy.
Yeah, it's so true.
It was awesome. It was a nice change, and I definitely remember that show. I did a rig rundown before that one.
Things
you could feel, the energy just sort of wasn't out there like we were used to. And, you know, it felt like that in the rooms. We still had fun, but yeah, it was dying down.
Yeah. And then Nashville too. I mean, Nashville is a tough town. I've seen so many tours that like you'll see on like a tour list. It's like everybody's selling out every theater and they come here. And for some weird reason, you think it'd be like, you know, it's Music City, quote unquote, but there's just something about it. But I saw in an interview with you where you said that you guys added the extra members so people would stop asking you about the two-piece thing. And is that true?
No, the biggest reason was because of how many tracks were on Pick Up Your Head. And I, you know, it came down to, we had a meeting with our label manager and I was like, okay, this record's great. Let's go out and tour with it. And it was kind of like, well, we have to play it. You know, how are we going to play it? It seemed like the only option was to either play it completely different, which didn't sound exciting because it never got a chance to sort of be played the normal way, or get other guys in. So we started looking for guys, you know, touring that, and we did that Rockstar Uproar tour as a five piece. Pretty much the whole end of that cycle we did as a five piece before we stripped back down.
And I thought it was cool, man, because to me, like, and not to compare like the bands or the sound, but like it reminded me of something like the Talking Heads or like the B-52s would do, where they would have all these random people just throwing percussion down, and it always filled up that space. Because you're right, so many bands, you know, even bands I've been in, you know, throw in a track and have the invisible tambourine going off, and that stuff. Yep. You know, I've never been a big fan of that myself either, so I thought it was cool when you guys had a full thing going on up there.
Yeah, it was fun, you know. It talk about boosting your overhead, you know what I mean? We had had such a self-contained machine. Now all of a sudden we had all these guys and a crew and we're in a bus, and you know how it goes. You want to feel like you're progressing, you're growing somewhat, you know. There's little earmarks that make you think, okay, we're not in the same place as we were last year. You know, little things that make tour life a little more comfortable since you're doing it so much. But
yeah.
I mean, we burnt out on that just the same. We're like, let's go back to a two piece. Then all of a sudden, a two piece is exciting again. You know, you're just always chasing excitement. That's the name of the game.
Is that why? Because you guys disbanded for a short time in 2015. You think that was that kind of the reason, just kind of being burnt out from all the touring and everything?
We were right, you know, Bright Antenna. We were right about to make another record. You know, everything was there, the money was there, and it just, Sean and I sort of got on the phone. We're like, man, we got nothing. Like, the last thing in the world we want to do is sort of see each other and write more music. But you know how it is. Like, then 6 months later, all of a sudden, you know, I'm back to writing tons of songs, and it's like, oh God, now I got to get back and do something. But yeah, I think it had just run its course. It felt like, we felt like we were doing it for the wrong reasons. We're like, and it's really hard for the two of us to operate that way, because the only thing we do is we get in a room and we jam. Nothing's written beforehand. We just, Sean plays a beat, I see what happens. And it just, we felt like we couldn't do that, so it didn't make sense. So we just kind of told them, look, you know, we need to pull out of this and get some perspective, and, you know, we need to want to do this again in order to make anything good.
After that, you put out in 2016 your solo record, Bloodlines. And was that the first?
Yeah.
Is that the first and only record you've ever done that doesn't have Sean on it?
Yeah. I mean, Sean had taught me over the years, you know, how to record. He taught me Pro Tools. He thought, you know, I picked up all my tricks from him and, you know, sort of ran with it hardcore. And then, once I knew how to do it, it's just like, I felt like, man, any idea I have, boom, I can make into a song. And, so I just started writing tons of stuff and, you know, and recording tons of stuff. And, that's when I kind of went to Bright Antenna. I said, look, you know, I don't know what's going on with Middle Class Rub, but here's some songs I have. I'd love to put out a record. And they said, sure, like, show us what you got. Let's do it. So I put that out, and then just digitally only, I put out another one in the same year called Life on the Run, but all super low profile. You know, I never toured on it. I didn't really do anything for it. So it exists out there, but that was sort of the extent of it, unfortunately.
Yeah. I know, it's a great record, man. It has that Middle Class Rut vibe, and the voice obviously sounds like you, obviously, but it definitely has a heavy vibe. And then you guys get back together. I guess you never really broke up. You just took an indefinite, kind of like a hiatus kind of thing. But then you get back for 2018 for Gutters, which I thought was an amazing record. And it's funny because my favorite song off that album, which now that I know that you could have almost been in Lifehouse, I guess it makes sense. But one of my favorite songs on that record is the song 3C, because it's like super light song, but like, it just kind of, to me, showcases the songwriting ability of you guys. You can get really heavy and you can get real stripped down with stuff like that. But how was the reaction to Gutters? Cause that's a great record too, man.
It was sort of the thing where Sean and I had been jamming. You know, he lives in Idaho. I live in Sac. So, but he had started flying out once a month, and then I'd built a studio out here, so we had a place where everything was set up, and we just started writing these songs, and we sort of made a deal. I felt like all the crowdfunding thing was huge at that time, and I said, look, let's take a gamble. Let's try and crowdfund something. If we make the money, we'll make a record. If not, then what's the point? You know, if we can't even get the few fans we have to pay for something like this, then, you know, we love making music, but you kind of need that from both ends. And so we put it up, and then boom, we got, you know, we made it no problem, and then booked some time. And it was exciting. It felt good to know. It felt like a payoff of like all the work we had done. Like, all right, now we know we can put out a record and do everything ourselves, you know, got vinyl made, got all this stuff made. Did all, you know, it was super empowering, really.
That's one of the cool things about those, like the Kickstarter, and there was another one too they had for a while. Like, there was a bunch of those different things you could raise money, and I always thought it was great because it really does show a direct connection to your fans, especially if you're a band that already has like a fan base. So I think those are amazing.
Yeah, yep.
The newest release you had, which I know technically came out in 2019 on vinyl, which was the split you did with Black Map, and it's now available on digital, but Tax on Death, and then one of the songs I thought was interesting, which I added to rotation here, I guess it was 2 weeks ago now, but you guys covered the old Sheila Devine song Hum. How did that come about? Because that's a band that not a lot of people know. When you put that out, I was like, that is awesome.
And then I just by chance in high school remember hearing that that band, and I got that record, New Parade, and just, I mean, it's still one of my favorite records. And every time I show it to someone, they're like, I've never heard of this band. And it was a weird Roadrunner band, you know, like it was a weird band that would have been on Roadrunner back then. But
yeah.
I don't know. It's just I've been talking because the drummer of Black Map, you know, lives a couple houses down from me, and I had showed him, you know, Sheila Devine, and we just started talking one night. We should do a split, you know, and then that's the sort of the idea went off. And I knew with their singer, and I knew what I could bring to it, obviously, with just the high screams and all that. And it was really effortless, you know, and it was a fun excuse to get everyone together and go in the studio and then have Sean record us all. It was a good time.
And then the song Tax on Death, I think, is a very cool, it just sounds like Middle Class Rut, but like, you know, the 2020 version of it, which I think is awesome. And I guess that leads me to my next question too. I mean, I know obviously 2020 is kind of a lost year as far as like touring goes.
Yeah.
and everything really, but what is like 2020 or what does 2021 look like? Is Middle Class Rut maybe going to do a new record? Do you think there'll be shows in the future, or you think you're just going to kind of stick to what you're doing right now?
It's hard to say. I mean, I definitely, there will be shows of some kind in the future. You know, I have sort of on the burner right now, a couple songs that are already mixed and ready to go that I'm working on putting out. This October is, you know, the 10th year anniversary of No Name, No Color.
Yeah.
And so the original plan was to tour on that, but, obviously, you know, those plans got put on hold. So, you know, the plan is just to keep jamming. And if we have stuff that we're excited to put out, we can put it out, you know.
Yeah.
But right now it's hard to sort of have any plans of any kind with what's going on. But I definitely don't, I mean, playing live is just something that's, you know, I think everyone's dying to do, whether it's go to see music or go to play music, just being around that sort of energy is crazy missed right now.
That's a weird time too, because I never thought, I mean, it's like at any point in my life did I ever think that live shows would just not be happening. It's such a strange existence here in 2020. It's crazy to think too that No Name, No Color is going to be 10 years old. We just, and you know, my band, we just celebrated 10 years too for our record. And I swear, man, like when I was a kid, everyone said time flies, but Jesus Christ, I'm like 10 years already? That's mind blowing.
Yeah, I know. God, it's crazy. it is, man. It is. I mean, there's all kind. You know, there's no shortage of ideas of things that you know, we want to do. It's a matter of doing them. That's all. And there's always way more ideas than our time to see them through. But yeah, I mean, that record was huge for us, and you know, we'd like to go out there and celebrate in some capacity. And there's, you know, when we did that last round of touring on Gutters, we only reached as far as maybe St. Louis. You know, there's always the plan to do the second half of that and hit the whole East Coast and parts of the South, but it just never wound up happening. So, you know, we still sort of are eyeing that in the future as well.
Well, I appreciate you taking the time, man, for real, to call in tonight. And it was an honor to have you on the show, man. I'm hoping to see more from you guys in 2021. And either way, man, check out the brand new stuff out of the new Split that's on Spotify right now. Tax on Death and Hum, two great songs. But Zack, I appreciate it, man.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.